Hi, everybody. I hope you can hear me. This is the broadcast of Professor Patrick Allitt of Emory University's presentation from Mrs. Richman's AP US History class of the year 2014 to 2015. For posterity, I will announce that it is April 24th, 2015. The AP exam is coming up soon, and I'd just like to thank Professor Allitt for speaking to our class and in a few minutes taking our questions. I encourage you all students, that is, to take notes and note down any questions that you might want to ask. Oh, and with that, I'll leave it to Professor Allitt, who has an excellent presentation prepared. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Jamie. It's a pleasure to be with you all. I can't see you, but I hope you can hear me clearly and that you'll be willing to send me questions. You can tell from my voice that I'm English, but I am in fact a professor of American history. That's because I was, after I left college in England, I came to America to go to graduate school in US history back in the late 1970s. And then through a whole series of coincidences, ended up staying here. I got married and my wife is American. I became a US citizen a few years ago. So now I feel equally at home in both countries and I love them both very much. Last year when I spoke to this group, I'd never taught AP US history. I often have students who themselves took it, but this year for the first time I've also been teaching it to two homeschoolers in the Los Angeles area. So I've got a new appreciation of the work you've been doing this year, and I wish you all the very best of luck when you take the exam, because I know how hard it is to get ready for it. There's such a lot to learn. I'm going to talk first about the Cold War and the conditions which made it so stressful. Obviously, the United States and the Soviet Union were allies in the war against Hitler in the early 1940s. But even though they were allies, there was a lot of tension inside their alliance. Once America entered the war in the December of 1941, the Russians hoped that the Americans would attack Western Europe as soon as possible, because the Russians were facing the full force of the German armies on the Eastern Front. And President Roosevelt at first was very enthusiastic about the idea of attacking Western Europe quickly to take the pressure off Stalin's armies. But the British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, warned Roosevelt two things. First of all, it's very difficult to launch a successful invasion of Western Europe, and we're not ready for it. And second, although for the moment we're allied with the Soviet Union, in the long run they're not going to be our friends, they're going to be our enemies. It actually suits us very well to have them tearing each other to pieces on the Eastern Front like that. And so in the summer of 1942, there wasn't an Anglo-American invasion of Western Europe. And then in the summer of 1943, there again wasn't an Anglo-American invasion of Western Europe. This is an example of something which didn't happen in history, which is nevertheless very important, because it had the effect of making Stalin, the Soviet leader, more and more angry and more skeptical of American promises. It wasn't until the summer of 44 that the D-Day invasion of Europe finally took place, which forced Hitler to divide his armies and made his ultimate defeat that much more likely. But already by then, there was a legacy of bitterness between the Russians and the Americans. On the American side, the Americans became deeply unhappy with Stalin because he failed to fulfill the promises he made at the Yalta Treaty when he met with Stalin and Churchill. The Western leaders thought that Stalin had promised that with the countries in Eastern Europe that were liberated from the Nazis, they were going to be made into self-governing democracies. But in fact, Stalin was determined to keep them as, in effect, colonies of the Soviet Union, places which were going to do exactly what the Soviet Union said and were going to have dictatorships which were totally sympathetic to the point of view of Moscow. So the Americans also had a feeling of betrayal when the war ended. And of course, everyone on the Western side of the Cold War alliance remembered that at the beginning of World War II, Hitler and Stalin had been allies. They joined together to defeat Poland. So the combination of these wartime stresses and the fact that communism and capitalism were totally antagonistic ideologies all had the effect of making American relations with the Soviet Union deteriorate very quickly in the late 1940s. Now, of course, the thing which ended World War II against Japan was the nuclear weapon. And both sides understood perfectly that from now on, nuclear weapons were going to be decisive. The Americans carried on building them as rapidly as they could. And the Soviet Union also started building them as rapidly as they could. And in 1949, were able to explode their own nuclear weapon for the first time. Now, unlike every previous weapon in world history, these things were so powerful that the incentives to not use them were incredibly high. There was a lot of debate inside the United States about whether it had been justifiable to use a nuclear weapon against Hiroshima and Nagasaki, because they're the ultimate weapons of indiscriminate destruction. They just destroy everything in the entire area. And it certainly was true that hundreds of thousands of people who couldn't be held responsible in any way for the Japanese war had nevertheless been killed in these explosions. And a lot of Americans, particularly American religious people, Christians, felt very, very uncomfortable about that. And so they started to say things like this: are we really going to describe ourselves as the defenders of Western civilization by threatening to completely exterminate our enemies? If we did that, we'd be denying the very principles that we say we live by. A very difficult ethical dimension to thinking about nuclear weapons. And of course, there's also a very difficult practical matter. Each side was aware by the mid-1950s that they had so much explosive power that they could completely destroy the other one, but that they, in retaliation, they would be destroyed as well. They'd reached a situation which was nicknamed MAD, M-A-D, Mutually Assured Destruction. Each one could completely annihilate the other. And both sides arrayed their weapons in such a way that they could be sure that even in the event of a surprise attack, they'd be able to fight back with such force that the enemy would be completely destroyed. So the reason that the Cold War remained cold, that is the reason the United States and the Soviet Union never did fight each other directly, was because each one was aware that the damage inflicted on it would be so great as to effectively destroy it completely. So that's an odd thing, isn't it? Both sides were very, very powerful and very powerless. It's a paradox which we hadn't really seen in the history of the world before. Now, in the early Cold War years, the Americans said to the people of East Germany and Hungary and Czechoslovakia and Poland, that is the countries behind the Iron Curtain, you should rebel against your Soviet masters and re-establish the freedom that you lost back in 1939 when Hitler invaded you. And the American government certainly implied that it would help them if they did that. And in 1956, for example, there was an uprising in Hungary. But the Soviet Union sent its tanks in to suppress this uprising and said to the Americans, if you intervene, we'll regard this as a signal for the onset of nuclear war. And the Americans realized, we're powerless. We can't risk it. No American was going to risk the destruction of the United States for the sake of helping the people of Hungary. It just seemed too remote. So each side then had to recognize the degree to which its power was very, very limited. Now, that also meant that, I mean, normally in wartime, it's an advantage to keep secrets from your enemy. And the Cold War was a period of intense mutual secrecy. On the other hand, there were circumstances where both sides had a common interest. One of the great anxieties of the 1950s was the fact that as both sides kept testing nuclear weapons, the amount of radioactive fallout in the atmosphere, radioactive debris, kept increasing. And in 1963, the two sides, the Soviet Union and the Americans, signed an agreement that they would no longer do nuclear weapons tests in the environment, in the atmosphere, the Atmospheric Test Ban Treaty. That was an interesting moment because it showed that although they were antagonists, nevertheless, they had a common interest in preserving the quality of the environment. It's really one of the first big environmental issues of the Cold War era. And similarly, a bit later on, they negotiated the Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty of the very early 1970s, the SALT I Treaty, where both sides recognized, we've now got weapons sufficient to destroy each other. It's completely futile for us to continue to make new ones. We're simply making we're sort of doubling and trebling our capacity to kill each other, and that's pointless. Now, all the way through the Cold War years, in America, because America does have freedom of speech and freedom of the press, American citizens were saying, why don't we have a policy in which we promise that we'll never use nuclear weapons first, a no first use policy? But this is something that the presidents and the generals were never willing to agree to. And here's why not. It's because the Americans recognize that as a democracy, there's something attractive about nuclear weapons, because they're so powerful that they deter the enemy for a relatively small expenditure of money. In other words, if the Americans promised that they'd never use them first, they'd need to have a much bigger conventional army. And building an army is very expensive. It forces men into the military where they don't want to go. It costs a lot. Whereas if you've got just nuclear weapons, they've got more destructive power, but they cost relatively less. In the 1950s, the Eisenhower administration actually had a word for it: more bang for the buck. In other words, we can spend a relatively small amount of money and still have this overwhelming deterrent power. And if we said we were never going to use them first, we'd have to have big conventional armies like the Soviet Union does. And so that meant that throughout the Cold War, the US Army was much smaller than the Soviet Army. And that if it had come to a conventional war of the kind that had been fought in the 1940s against the Nazis, the American Army would probably lose because it was outnumbered. But the Americans said, as long as we continue to hold out the threat that we'll use nuclear weapons first, we'll still be able to deter even a conventional Soviet nuclear attack. So anyway, there are some of the complexities of nuclear weapons. Let me move on now to talk about the relationship between this and the Korean and Vietnamese wars. Because the Americans and the Russians couldn't fight each other directly because it was too dangerous, what they did instead was that they had client states around the world. Every country which wasn't the USA or the Soviet Union had to decide which side was it going to lean towards. The benefits of leaning towards one side or the other was that you'd get military aid and economic aid and so on. And both sides had very extensive lists of clients who sympathized with them. But sometimes if these clients themselves were internally divided, like Korea and Vietnam, actual war could break out there. And this is what happened in 1950. North Korea, with Soviet backing, attacked South Korea, which had American backing. So then President Truman, who'd become president in 1945 and then had won the election of 1948, Truman had to decide, are we going to commit American troops to prevent the North Korean conquest of South Korea? Some of the generals said, the place we need to worry about the Cold War is in Europe. Berlin is the place where we need to be focusing our attention. But others of the generals and others of the political advisors to President Truman said, no, we need to fight in Korea, even though we didn't anticipate that we were going to have to. Because we've got to send an absolutely clear and unambiguous message to the Soviet Union and to communists everywhere that we're going to fight them wherever they attack. And of course, in making that decision and in actually sending the American army into Korea, they were responding to their memory of what had happened in the 1930s. They looked back on the 1930s and said, if only we'd been willing to confront Hitler sooner. We made the mistake of appeasing him, of saying to Hitler, all right, you can do this in Austria. All right, you can do this in Czechoslovakia. If only we'd fought him early when he was weak, we could have defeated him easily. In the end, we waited too long to go to war, and that made it much more difficult ultimately to destroy him. Let's not make that mistake again. Yeah. In other words, everyone's remembering the lesson that they'd misunderstood the previous time. And similarly, a bit later on, when the Americans went into Vietnam, they did it not because they believed that North Vietnam presented a direct threat to America. It didn't. I mean, hardly anyone in America even knew how to speak Vietnamese. And 19 out of every 20 American people couldn't even have shown on a map where Vietnam was. But the same idea persisted. We've got to fight the enemy when he's weak and far away, because if we don't, we're going to have to fight him later when he's much stronger and much closer. Now, unfortunately, historical lessons don't always work twice. It would have been right, it would have been reasonable to attack Hitler in 1936 as soon as he started violating the principles of the Treaty of Versailles. And when we look back on it now, I think most people say, if only we'd been more aggressive in stopping Hitler. But on the other hand, there's hardly anybody left in America now who thinks that the Americans did the right thing in Vietnam. What happened instead was that in the attempt to prevent communist advances into South Vietnam, the Americans sent in more and more people, more and more money, more and more equipment, and weren't able to prevail. They couldn't win a decisive military victory, partly because they weren't willing to use nuclear weapons, and partly because the side which America was supporting in Vietnam was simply too politically unpopular, even among the ordinary people of South Vietnam itself. And so when we look back on the 30s and on the 60s, it's easy to draw the conclusion that the Americans were wrong twice. They were wrong for delaying so long in the 30s, and they were wrong for engaging so actively in the 1960s. That's a very interesting example of the relationship between the study of history and the decision about what to do next. Obviously, every administration, every president, and every Congress looks at the world, tries to decide what will help it, but can only draw its information from history. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to apply the right historical lesson. It's necessary to have the historical knowledge, but that still doesn't mean that you're certain to not make mistakes. Now, another very interesting thing happened in the early 1970s, in addition to the SALT I treaty, and this was President Nixon's visit to China. As you probably know, in 1949, the Chinese Revolution had brought Mao Zedong to power, and Mao was the leader of the Chinese communists. Now, in the late 40s and early 50s, American policymakers assumed that communism was the same everywhere, and that because Russia and China were both now communist countries, they must have shared interests. That is, they were making a bigger and bigger red stain on the map. They were going to, and they represented an increasing threat to America. But by watching what happened in the relationship between China and Russia in the 1950s and 60s, the American policymakers eventually realized, no, they've still got national interests, and these national interests lead them very often to disagree with each other. And therefore, President Nixon and his Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger, decided it makes good political sense for us to make friends with China because the enemy of our enemy is our friend. That is, we can put a little bit more diplomatic pressure on the Russians, we can make them more cooperative, if we've got the support rather than the antagonism of communist China. So I think that was the moment at the very beginning of the 70s when American policymakers developed a more nuanced sense of the variations even within the communist regimes and began to recognize that national interests were as important as ideological ones. If you like, when we come to thinking about questions, ask me more about this because it's all incredibly complicated. But what I'd like to do now is talk about what was going on inside the United States at the same time as the Cold War and the way in which these things could sometimes be connected. Think first of all about the civil rights movement. I'm sure you've all studied it, and it's very likely that you'll have questions on the AP exam about the civil rights movement. Well, one of the first things that was said by the defenders of segregation in the South when Martin Luther King began the Montgomery bus boycott, and then as gradually the sit-in movement and the freedom rides began and the civil rights movement became more and more active. One of the things segregationists said was, King is a communist. And the reason they said it was not because they thought he was a communist, but because they knew that the very best way to discredit anybody in the 50s was to allege that they were a communist. It was a brilliant way of depriving someone you didn't like of their political credibility. But luckily, from King's point of view, there was no evidence at all that he was a communist. Quite the opposite. He was a minister of the gospel. Nobody could be further from communism than practicing Christians. And King, obviously a very, very talented speaker, was able to preach the gospel and say, Jesus himself would be horrified by the situation of racial segregation here. Nobody can claim to be a Christian if they're also actively defending segregation. And of course, bit by bit, as he preached that message, more and more white Christians started to get bad consciences about the fact that they until then had supported segregation, either actively or passively. But there's another, a very interesting aspect to this, which relates to the question of the Cold War. That have you all seen the picture, the photographs of the police or the fire department turning fire hoses on demonstrators in Birmingham, Alabama, and knocking them over with those very, very powerful fire hoses? Or the way in which the police set attack dogs against civil rights demonstrators? These were newspaper photographs which horrified Americans who saw them, because it said, look at this. Here are these peaceful, non-violent civil rights demonstrators, and they're being attacked by the people who are supposed to be upholding law and order. But not only were they headline news in America, they were also headline news in Russia. The Russian newspapers had these photographs on their front pages, along with stories which said things like this. The Americans are hypocrites. They claim to be the defenders of freedom, but they persecute 1/9 of their own population on the grounds of these people's race. The defenders of freedom are us, the Russians, and the Americans don't really mean it. Now, of course, when President Kennedy, and then a little bit later President Johnson, see stories like this, they realize that the accusation of communism, although that the kind of propaganda war, that the Americans are going to lose the propaganda war if they carry on permitting Southern segregationists to act in this way. So it's really at that moment that the Democratic Party, then in power, the Kennedy administration, starts to say, we've got to put our weight behind civil rights legislation. And we've got to make sure that things like these attacks never happen again, because they're totally discrediting us in the international community. This was also the period, incidentally, when the British Empire in Africa was being dismantled, and the French colonies in Africa were coming to an end, and new African nations were becoming independent. Now, one of the things the Americans very much wanted to do was to get the sympathetic interest of these new black African nations. And it understood that it couldn't possibly do that if it was persecuting its own African-American citizens. So that's another reason why the government, the federal government led by the Democrats in the early 60s, finally really started to get on board with civil rights. But in doing so, they were always a little bit half-hearted. And the reason for that was because if you look at the history of the Democratic Party, you'll find that it was made up of northern urban working class people, factory workers in Pittsburgh and Cleveland and Chicago and places like that. And on the other hand, nearly all the white population of the South. It was called the Solid South. And for a century since Reconstruction, Democrats had always won Southern elections, but only whites had been voting in those elections. And so President Kennedy in 63, obviously not knowing that he was about to be assassinated, was looking ahead to the election of 1964 and saying, how can I be sure that I'm going to win re-election? Well, one thing I've got to do is to hold on to the Solid South, the white Southern voters. And he understood that if he started making concessions to the African-American, the civil rights movement, he was likely to start losing those voters. So he got a motive to support civil rights, which was international public opinion, and he got a motive to not support it, which was getting the white voters in the election of 64. You see the way in which that, again, creates one of these lovely historical paradoxes. In the end, first Kennedy, and then after his death, Johnson did support civil rights, but in doing so, they started to lose the support of the white voters in the South. I mean, one thing that's happened in the South between the 1960s and the present is that more and more white Southern voters have become Republicans. There were virtually no Republicans in the South between the 1860s and the 1960s, or at least there were no white ones. Most of the black people couldn't vote. So that set off a huge shift in electoral politics that's interesting to think about. Now, here's another related question to think about in connection with the civil rights movement. When you look at the resistance to the civil rights movement, are you struck by how strong it was or by how weak it was? The argument that it was strong resistance is that 10 years after the Brown decision in the mid-60s, still wasn't very much desegregation. And even 20 years after, by 1973, many areas of the rural South were still racially segregated. On the other hand, that's one way of looking at it. The resistance to desegregation was very strong. On the other hand, if you compare it to what was happening at the same time in South Africa, which was also a segregated society, you have to be struck by how slight the resistance was. See, in South Africa, hundreds of whites were willing to die for the principle of preserving racial segregation, apartheid. They died for it. Whereas in America, no whites died to preserve segregation. When it came to the point, they gave up very quickly. Although the Southern congressmen and Southern senators declared that they were going to have a policy of massive resistance, actually they didn't. The federal government said, if you resist the civil rights legislation, we're no longer going to give you any federal money for building schools or for building highways or for all your state projects. At which point, nearly all the Southern state governments gave up. Yeah, they folded up really, really quickly and said, oh, all right, we'll have desegregation. So in other words, I think it's important again to hold on to both sides of that story. The attacks on civil rights workers were certainly disgraceful and painful. And from a civil rights worker's point of view, it must have seemed agonizingly slow and difficult. But if you put it in an international perspective, it suddenly starts to seem rather different. The ease of American desegregation by comparison with South African desegregation is the relevant story to think about there. Let me just mention one more thing, and then I'll encourage you to ask me some questions. And that is this. You probably know from your studies over the course of this year that when the Great Depression began after 1929, it dragged on all the way through the 1930s. And although the New Deal did certain things to help put some people back to work, what it couldn't do was to restore the economic vitality of the 1920s. And it was only the onset of the Second World War which finally led to the end of the Great Depression. It was in 1940 that America achieved a level of full employment again, by which time the war is roaring along in Europe, and Britain in particular needs American goods. Now, during World War II, a lot of Americans were afraid, including a lot of very significant Americans, economists and policymakers, were afraid that when the war ended, the Depression would come back. They had this idea that we now live in an economy which is so productive that what we can't do is find a way to have the stuff we can make be purchased and consumed. But in fact, of course, the Depression didn't come back. And so one of the big questions that historians ask is, why didn't the Depression come back? And the answer they usually give, well, it's made up of two parts, and I'll tell you what they are. The first is that the Second World War ended, but at once the Cold War began. And that led to an enormous amount of energy and money and employment in defense-related industries, the building up of what President Eisenhower called the military-industrial complex. That was one part of it. But the other big change in the 1940s is that it was in the 1940s that ordinary working people started earning much more money than they ever had done previously. Wages were very, very high in the 1940s because anyone who wanted to hire someone had got to pay a lot because it was hard to find workers. Millions of men were fighting abroad, and all the rest of the men and lots of American women were all at work and had to be paid a lot to do the jobs for reasons relating to supply and demand. Now, they made so much money, but they weren't able to spend most of it because you couldn't make and buy consumer goods during the Second World War. The economy was geared nearly entirely to the war effort itself. So coming out of the war, there's an incredibly a huge pent-up demand for consumer goods, and people have got the money to pay for it. And so it's starting after 45 that ordinary citizens begin buying cars and houses and education and consumer goods in huge quantities. And they're able to carry on doing so because American wages were so high. And it's really at this point that economists started to understand that the way to have a really prosperous economy in a society like the United States is that you've got to have high wages. Because if you don't, if you have low wages, people aren't going to have the buying power to buy stuff. Yeah, it's a very, very simple supply and demand relationship. And bit by bit, the lesson was learned in the late 40s and 50s. We've got to keep wages high Because if but look at it from the point of view of a business owner. A business owner wants to make a profit, and therefore he's got an incentive to make wages low, because if wages are low, profits are going to be higher. But he also knows that if all the other business owners also keep wages low, there won't be enough buying power in the population as a whole, and therefore the stuff they're all making can't get sold, which is what had happened in the late 20s and early 30s. So it's another of these historical paradoxes. I keep presenting you with them. A businessman has got an incentive to make wages high, even though he's also got an incentive to make wages low. But anyway, the long run outcome of this balancing act was in fact to make American wages high, so much so that the 1950s and the 1960s in the United States, this was by far the wealthiest nation in the entire history of the entire world. It was so wealthy that it could start asking questions like this: why do we still have poverty? Only a very, very wealthy nation can ask questions like, why do we still have poverty? In other words, throughout most of the history of the world, you never had to ask, why have we got poverty? Because nearly everybody was poor. Poverty is normal, and wealth is exceptional. But suddenly, by the 1950s and 60s in America, it's the other way around. The normal thing was prosperity, affluence, and poverty had become the exceptional thing, which was still suffered by a minority of the population, but potentially looked as though it could be wiped out once and for all. All right, there we are. That was about 32 or 3 minutes worth. If you've got some questions, tell me what they are and I'll try and answer them.
Thanks very much. We've got one question that's come in already from Laramie Smith.
Okay.
She says, a Cypriot professor once told me that the world wars provoked much of the severe nationalism that we see today in some Eastern Bloc and Mediterranean countries. Despite their global nature, the wars created ideological isolation. And she wants to know, what are your thoughts?
Well, Laramie, I think that's a very, very good question. It is true that particularly the First World War had the effect of intensifying nationalist feelings. Because one of the things it did was to break up the old Austro-Hungarian Empire and break up the old Ottoman Empire. The cost of losing World War I was that all sorts of new countries came into existence: Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, independent Poland, independent Hungary, and so on. Places like this, which previously had been parts of these great ethnically complicated empires. But it's true that the only way, the obvious way to build pride in a new nation is by saying to the people who live there, you are parts of this nation, and the people around us are not. And of course, that itself can have very adverse consequences when nationalism becomes strident and belligerent. It can, in fact, lead to warfare. So there are historians who look back nostalgically to the pre-World War I era and say, in some ways, the long stability of the 19th century was hampered or marred by the rise of romantic nationalism. I mean, one of the most powerful forces of the 1800s was nationalism. And it was in the 1800s that obviously American nationalism itself, growing out of the Revolution, grew very, very strong. And if you look at the whole of American history in the 1800s, American patriotism is a very, very powerful force. And periodically, nationalist leaders from Eastern Europe would come to America and have triumphant processions through America saying, we want Italian nationalism, we want Hungarian nationalism. And the Americans were very ready to listen to that. In fact, there were even some Americans in 1861 who said, in the Northerners, who said, if the Confederate states want to secede, we should let them. Because if they believe that they are, in fact, a separate nation, it's hopeless to try to prevent them from becoming one. Obviously, that wasn't the view that Abraham Lincoln took. Lincoln and the Republicans took the exact opposite view and said, no, once you're part of the Union, you're part of it forever. And the most important thing is the preservation of the Union. But anyway, to come back to the question, it's certainly true that nationalism is a very mixed blessing. And that one of the characteristics of the 20th century, and one of the things that made it unstable, was the intensification of militant nationalism.
Thanks. We have a couple more questions coming in. I see most of you are figuring out how to use the Q&A app If you really can't figure out how to use it and you have a question, just email me, because I actually have not been on your end for an entire year, so I can't remember how it works from your end. However, we have a question from our TA, Nathan Emory. How much do you think the American public influenced Cold War decision-making? For example, do you think public discontent influenced Nixon's withdrawal of troops from Vietnam?
My answer, Nathan, is that public opinion was incredibly important. That the great difference between the Americans and the Soviet Union in the Cold War period was that Americans were allowed to and encouraged to express their opinions, and the Russians weren't. And so that always meant that American presidents had to conduct their foreign policy with an awareness of the public mood. And what started to happen with the Vietnam War is that it grew rapidly more and more unpopular. When the Americans committed troops in a large way in 1965, at first, most Americans accepted the government description of the policy as necessary. And although they didn't want to do it, they said, well, it's necessary, just as our fathers fought in World War II, so now we've got to fight in Vietnam. But as the inability to win and as the moral ambiguities of the war kept accumulating, more and more young men, particularly of draft age, started to protest against it, started to desert from the army, started to resist the draft. Then more and more middle-aged people said, this isn't like World War II. We had a justified reason to fight then, but now we don't. And of course, these are people who vote. And so President Johnson dropped out of the presidential election of 1968 because by then he was so unpopular for Vietnam. And President Nixon, coming in, winning that election, realized, I've got to find a way to get the United States out of Vietnam because it's politically ruinous to stay in. He knew that leaving aside everything related to Watergate, obviously, Nixon knew that before he came up for re-election in 72, he got to have detached the Americans from Vietnam. That remains a very important issue, actually, the connection between public opinion and foreign policy. The Army drew this conclusion. If possible, we must never again rely upon the draft, conscripts. We must try to rely on a volunteer army, because then the people in the army have joined it with at least some degree of voluntarism. They've decided to join the army. Think about the wars that we've just been through in Iraq and Afghanistan, and in fact, we're just in some ways still going on. The reason they were so much less unpopular than Vietnam is because the people who've been fighting there were people who joined the military voluntarily. If people who didn't want to go had been forced to join the military, there would have been infinitely more protest against the wars themselves. So yes, foreign policy and public opinion interlock very closely.
Great, thanks. Now we have another question from Morgan Magnuson, who's a member of my study group. Hi, Morgan. And she has a question more based on domestic issues, domestic policy. She says, a professor in a college class I sat in on said that life in the 1950s was a facade, that it wasn't really as wonderful as it is viewed. Is this true? And if so, what does he mean?
Thanks, Morgan. That's a very interesting question. It is true that we now sometimes, or some people in America today, look back on the 1950s as though it was a golden age. And that's unwise, because every single age in the history of the world has looked back on previous ages and said, oh, if only we lived then. In other words, there's a kind of unquenchable human tendency to be nostalgic. And obviously what nostalgia does is that it takes the good aspects of the past and leaves out the bad aspects. There were certainly things which were attractive about life in the 50s, but there were also things that were very unattractive about it. On the good side, it was much more materially secure than ever before. Families if you were born in, let's say, 1920, that means that you were 10 when the Great Depression was really getting serious. And it means that during your teenage years, you probably grew up in very, very poor or stressful conditions of poverty. Then when you were 20 or 21, you had to go off to fight in World War II. And if you're a man, or if you're a woman, you had to go to work in the factories knowing that your boyfriend was fighting in Iwo Jima and was in danger of being killed. But then suddenly in the 50s, you've got all the stuff you never dreamed you were ever going to have. A good job with high pay. You've got a suburban home, which you can buy on the GI Bill. You've gone to college, also on the GI Bill. You can afford far more consumer goods than ever before. And you look around at people like you and say, wow, isn't this incredible? We could never have dreamed life was going to be like this back in the wretched old 30s. It really is wonderful. On the other hand, the 50s was a period of anxiety. I mean, because every day you'd hear in the press, the Russians have invented another even more powerful nuclear weapon. We've got to practice air raid drills because at any moment the great nuclear war might break out. And this great cloud of dread did hang over the nation as a whole. And it was the period of McCarthyism. I'm sure you've studied McCarthyism as well. The fear that communism was not only a threat in the Soviet Union, it was also a threat in the United States. And so all sorts of horrible violations of ordinary citizens' civil rights took place because of the suspicion or the allegation that they were communists. So it certainly isn't the case that ordinary Americans felt entirely secure and happy in the 50s. There was a feeling of anxiety hanging over them. And what we need to do as historians is remember both sides of that. And it's also true, by the way, that by our standards, they didn't lead very luxurious lives. All kinds of things we take for granted now, they didn't take for granted then. But it was a life which was more luxurious than what had gone before, but by our standards, a fairly harsh one.
All right, thank you. I have a question now, actually, that I'd like to ask on behalf of the class.
Okay.
Who would you say are some of the most important people that we should know from this Cold War and to the present period, other than presidents? Because I find in APUSH it's easy for people to keep track of presidents because, you know, you have one at a time and they come in order. But other people, political advisors, activist figures, maybe writers that have had an influence, who are a handful of the most important people that we should remember?
Very good question. Well, in thinking about foreign policy, you should know a little bit about George Kennan. I don't know if you came across his name. He was really the architect of the American policy of containment. In 1946, as it became clear that America was going to probably face a long and very tense standoff with the Soviet Union, this man, George Kennan, K-E-N-N-A-N, he was a senior policy advisor to the State Department, and he spent some time at the American Embassy in Moscow, wrote a very long and influential telegram, which later was written into a kind of an article in the journal Foreign Affairs, in which he said, we've got to adopt a policy towards the Soviet Union of consistent confrontation. He called it containment, and that became the standard phrase used for American policy towards the Soviet Union. We can't attack them directly because we can't risk nuclear war, but what we can do is to show that wherever they attempt to advance anywhere in the world, we're going to be ready to confront them. And that really did become the basis of the American policy, which the Truman government adopted. And it was partly because of Kennan's influence that the Americans decided that they weren't going to withdraw back into their old tradition of isolationism. You probably know that between George Washington and World War I, the big story of American foreign policy is how little of it there was. You know, the Americans really were leaving the rest of the world to its own devices. Not totally, but mainly. And then after World War I, when America was clearly the most powerful nation in the world, it didn't take on a very aggressive role in the rest of the world, but again drew back. And so after World War II, the question still persisted. What are we going to do next? Are we going to become the world's policeman? Are we going to take a leading active role in world affairs? Or are we once again going to return to isolationism? And the answer was, we're going to take a leading role. We're going to play a big role in the United Nations. We're going to lead NATO. We're going to lead the free world. Yeah? And Kennan was one of the people who made that decision. Equally important, I think, is George Marshall. Marshall was a senior general who then became Secretary of State and who then launched the Marshall Plan in 1948. I don't know if have you studied the Marshall Plan? This is itself a very important moment. As Europe was divided between a communist East and a capitalist West, remember that this is an area which has been, this is where the fighting took place in World War II, and it had been very, very heavily damaged, particularly by bombing raids on both sides. And George Marshall said, it's in America's interest to give an enormous amount of economic aid to the Western European countries to enable them to recover their economic vitality. If they remain economically weak, they're much more likely to become vulnerable to communism. But if we can make them strong, they're going to elect governments which believe in a free market economy. So the Marshall Plan was a calculated risk by the Americans to support the economic revival of Western Europe. And it worked brilliantly well. That's why through the 60s, 70s and 80s, Western Europe was rich and Eastern Europe was poor. And all the people of Eastern Europe knew it. They knew that they were living in a poor zone. They knew that they were being dominated by Soviet tyrants, and they longed to get away from it. So Marshall's the second one. I think another very important person, totally different kind of thing, is Daniel Ellsberg. I wonder if you have you come across that name?
I think so, but I'm not sure that everyone will have a clear association for who exactly he was.
Okay, Daniel Ellsberg, E-L-L-S-B-E-R-G. He worked for the Pentagon, and he became progressively more and more dismayed during the Vietnam War at the way in which the Army and the Pentagon and the State Department were systematically telling lies to the American public, that they wouldn't admit to the reality that they couldn't defeat the North Vietnamese and they couldn't defeat the Viet Cong. And finally, he gathered together a lot of papers, classified documents, and gave them to the New York Times and the Washington Post. And the New York Times and the Washington Post did, in fact, publish them. And they proved beyond doubt that the Americans weren't winning in Vietnam and that the government had been lying to them. Now, that, combined with the Watergate scandal, which came two or three years later, with the work of the journalists Woodward and Bernstein, the Washington Post journalists who broke the Watergate story, also had the effect of showing American citizens, senior members of your government are not telling you the truth. They're lying to you. They're violating the electoral procedures that we say we believe in. They're fighting with your sons and the money you've paid in taxes without telling you how they're fighting. They're committing atrocities in some cases. All these things collectively have the effect of undermining ordinary citizens' faith in government. If you look back to the 40s and 50s, most American citizens absolutely believed that what the government said was true and reliable and dependable. But after the Pentagon Papers, Ellsberg, and after the Watergate scandal of the early 70s, more and more Americans started to become skeptical. They realized that government sometimes has a motive to not tell the truth. And that's a legacy we live with today. I mean, it's good and bad. The bad part is that there are people who now say, if a politician's saying it, it must be untrue. That's going too far. On the other hand, it's certainly a good idea for citizens to listen to what the politicians say and be ready to take it skeptically. So those are some people. And one more, obviously I've already mentioned him and you know all about him. This is Martin Luther King. He demonstrated that an ordinary citizen can make an enormous amount of difference in American life. In other words, he was willing to take risks. He was willing to be imprisoned. He was willing to be persecuted. And in doing so, transformed the situation in American life in a way which must have been unimaginable. I mean, when we look, because we know what did happen, it's easy for us to assume that it was bound to happen. But actually, without particular people doing particular things, it might very well not have happened. And the really astonishing achievement of King and the Civil Rights Movement is to completely revolutionize American ideas about race relations.
Thanks. I'm getting several more questions on email and a few on the Q&A list. So we'll get through as many of them as we can in the minutes remaining. We have a question from Mrs. Richman, actually. She says, could you talk a bit about some of the ironies about Betty Friedan, including some of the things you shared in your Great Courses lecture on her in your American Identity series? Say, was she really a typical suburban housewife, or was there more in her background that she may have tried to hide a bit?
Good question. Well, Betty Friedan was the author of The Feminine Mystique, really the book which is regarded as the great opening salvo of the women's movement. And then later on, and the theme of the book is this: American women today, middle-class women, are in one way very privileged. They are materially secure, they're highly educated, and yet most of them are stuck at home being wives and mothers, and they find it boring and tedious, and they need career opportunities. And she was then one of the founders of now the National Organization of Women, which campaigned to eliminate legal discrimination against women. For example, in the early 1960s, when she wrote the book, it was perfectly legal for a corporation to advertise a job, but say only men need apply. And there was a very strong tradition that certain jobs would be done only by men and certain other jobs only by women. She and her organization campaigned successfully so that when civil rights legislation was passed in the mid-60s, it said, not only is it illegal to discriminate by race, it's also illegal to discriminate by gender. Yeah, you can't say men only, and you certainly can't say whites only. What you had to say instead was, you know, we need a person to do this job. But as Mrs. Richman says, Betty Friedan was anything but a normal housewife. Obviously, it's impossible to imagine an ordinary housewife writing the book, because Friedan was able to look at what was happening and think about it in holistic ways. Yeah, she'd been a member of the American Communist Party, and had been politically very active in the 1940s, belonged to a community of New York radicals who were highly unrepresentative of the American population as a whole. But of course, in the 50s, she started doing the work which led to the feminine mystique in the 50s, writing articles for women's magazines, and then eventually putting the whole thing together in a book. She knew that if it became public knowledge that she'd been a communist, the book itself would be discredited the moment it came out, or even before it came out, because its critics would be able to say, oh, well, this is communist propaganda. Now, in fact, I think most historians today would say Betty Friedan, like Martin Luther King, had a very important role in transforming gender relations, and she was justified in hiding this element of her past. Because it isn't as though she was trying to turn America into a communist country. What she was trying to do was to turn it into a less sexist country, which most of us now, I think, is an entirely reasonable thing to do. But yes, there certainly is this fascinating element of her background.
All right. Now I'd like to mention another question from my email from Alex Gallagher, who was wondering if you could talk a bit about the changing economic conditions in the U.S. in the last few decades of the 20th century, like stagflation and Reaganomics.
Okay. Thanks, Alex. That's a good question as well. Economists disagree about everything. And if I don't know how deeply you've gone into it, but when you read economic history by a conservative, as you're reading it, you think, yes, 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 it all sounds exactly right. And then you read economic history by a liberal historian, and again, it all sounds exactly right. Yes, yes, yes. Because each one has got ways of deploying the evidence which makes it seem extremely plausible. Now, various things did happen in the late 20th century with enormous consequences for the future. One of the great fears of the 1970s was that we were using natural resources at such a rate that they were all going to run out. Yeah, and in fact, various famous books are written in the 70s, like a book called The Limits to Growth, which published in 1972, I think, or three, which said, by the year 2000, we'll have less of everything because we're using up all the oil. We're using up the resources. We're going to be poorer people. President Carter commissioned a report called the Global 2000 Report to the President. It's 800 pages long, but you can summarize it in the same way. We're running out of everything. We've used it up indiscriminately, and we've been wasteful, and now we're going to have a poorer future. And of course, that proved to be totally untrue. It isn't as though we were poorer in the year 2000. On the contrary, we were richer. And so that's one example. Here's another one. In the 50s and 60s, you often heard the phrase, the population explosion. The population is growing so rapidly that by the year 2000, there's going to be far too many people in the world, and most of them will be starving. And a man called Paul Ehrlich, who wrote a book called The Population Bomb, which was published in 1968, said, by 1980, Americans are going to be starving because there won't be enough food. And he explained why the rate of population growth was completely unsustainable. Now, of course, both these alarms, the one about population and the one about resources, proved to be totally untrue. And so, of course, we're very interested in why they proved to be untrue. The one about population, it is true that the population was growing very fast, but luckily the food supply was growing even faster. This is the period of the Green Revolution, when crop yields all around the world were growing very, very rapidly indeed. So that the food, so that although more people are staying alive because of improvements in nutrition and improvements in medicine, it's also true that the food supply is more than keeping up. And as infrastructure improved around the world, as better roads and better railroads and better air travel gave access to places where famines happened, famine became less and less common. Also, an amazing thing, that a population of 1 billion in 1900 had far more famines than a population of 7 billion does now. It seems impossible, and yet it's true. I mentioned that point also about, let me tell you the little thing about the natural resources now. There was a famous bet in 1980 between Paul Ehrlich, the man who'd written this book, The Population Bomb, and an economist called Julian Simon. Ehrlich said, we're running out of everything. And as we start running out, the price of things is going to go up because they're becoming more scarce. To which Julian Simon said, no, we're not running out of anything. Strange and paradoxical as it may seem, things are becoming more plentiful. And because they're becoming more plentiful, the prices are going down. Anyway, these two men, they're both public figures, and they both often made speeches in public. They had a bet. They each put $1,000 into an imaginary bank account. And they said, let's follow the price of five commodities. They chose five metals. And if by 1990, 10 years after this bet starts, if the price of these metals has gone up, that will suggest that they're becoming more scarce and that Ehrlich is right, and then he'll get the money. But if the price has gone down, that will suggest that they're becoming more common. So the price will be less, and therefore Simon will get the money because he'll turn out to have been right. Now, in 1990, Julian Simon won overwhelmingly. He didn't just win by a bit, he won hugely, which appeared to vindicate his view that things are becoming more plentiful. Anyway, Ehrlich, the loser of the bet, said, wow, that's amazing. I thought I was going to be right, at least on the question of copper, which was one of the metals they'd chosen. But because copper was very in short supply in the late 70s leading up to the bet. Anyway, Julian Simon's answer to him went like this. It's true that copper was in short supply, and because it was, the incentive to look for an alternative was very high. And it's no coincidence that it should be just then, in the late 70s and early 80s, that fiber optics technology should be developed and should come online. And fiber optics can now do all kinds of jobs that previously had to be done with copper. So the demand for copper has diminished because now we've got something better to do it. In other words, the really decisive factor is human ingenuity. The incentive to come up with an alternative stimulates the ingenuity, and the alternative is found. So, and Julian Simon also said this, which to me seems like a very sensible remark. He said, resources isn't just stuff. Resources is a combination of stuff plus an idea about what to do with the stuff. And he gave this example. He said, think about oil. We talk a lot about oil now, obviously, because it's a very important resource. But there was plenty of oil in the world, but it didn't become a resource until 1859, because that's when people worked out how to refine it into usable lamp fuel and usable lubricants. So it became a resource once somebody thought about what to do with it. Yeah. And then the really important component of it is the idea. He wrote a book called The Ultimate Resource, saying it's humans are the ultimate resource.
Thanks. That makes a lot of sense. We've got three more questions that we've received in the Q&A app and my email. Okay. So if you'd like to cover them very quickly, we could do that. Or if you'd rather me just pick one for the final question.
Let me do them all three quickly.
All right. Well, one really quick one is Rachel Coyle's question. You talked some about how we waited too long to enter World War II and attack Hitler, but we fought too much and too soon in the war spawned by the Cold War. What are some of the reasons the U.S. kept its policy of neutrality during World War II for so long?
Again, it relates directly to this matter of the relationship between public opinion and foreign policy. Most Americans in the 1930s very much didn't want to go to war again. They believed that the Americans had been deceived into World War I by munitions manufacturers, who they called the merchants of death. And they took the view, let the peoples of Europe tear each other to pieces. It's got nothing to do with us. And because President Roosevelt was a Democratic a democratically elected president. And because he wanted to run for president again in 1940, he said, I'm not going to do something which will antagonize most of the voters. So it wasn't until after his third inauguration in the winter of 41 that he started becoming more sympathetic to the idea of getting into the war. So it's a public opinion question.
Thanks. Our next question is another one from Morgan Magnuson. How well do you think the policy of containment worked? Overall, just a broad assessment.
I think it worked brilliantly well, that the Americans couldn't have done better than they did. Because in the end, we emerged in 1989 without having a nuclear war, which is a surprise, really. Usually in the history of the world, when weapons are invented, they're used. And they're usually used a lot. So to avoid nuclear war was brilliant, and the policy of containment made that happen. And what's even better is that the Soviet Union, this great communist tyranny, collapsed. So we were left with a vindication of our economic and political system, that democracy and freedom of religion and freedom of the press and freedom of speech and the free market all survived, and communism failed. And again, we have to credit the policy of containment with making that happen. So full marks.
Wow, thanks. And one final question, if you can stay just another minute,
yep.
Would that be okay? From my email from Marianne Valerio wants to know, do you think there is ever a point in history studies when you come too close to the modern era to have the kind of perspective you need to be discussing things from the perspective of history rather than current events?
No, I don't think there's ever a moment. And in fact, I think we're doing it all the time. What journalists do is usually write down the very first draft of history, because they're describing what events happened yesterday. And as they're doing it, they're organizing it. And then later generations of historians will reorganize the material they find that the journalists said. But we've got, I mean, I think as human beings, we've got this instinctive propensity to want to understand ourselves and to keep records of what we've done. So although it's true that if you write very contemporary history, you're going to be more influenced by your opinions about the rights and wrongs of what's happening, nevertheless, it's something that we do, and it's something that we should do. So I counsel you all to be willing to study history right up to the present.
Thanks so much. That's a really interesting idea. I hadn't thought about it that way before.
Good.
Well, I'd like to thank you for speaking to our class. I know that they've all really enjoyed it and appreciated it. We've got some good questions, and I know your presentation was very helpful.
Thanks very much.
Thanks so much for speaking.
Yeah, very, very best of luck on May the 8th. I hope the exam gives you exactly what you wanted and that the DBQ is the one you hope it's going to be, and so on. So
happened to me last year, so you
good.
Never know.
All right.
Well, thank you so much.
Thanks, then. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.